Oh, thanks so much for being with us. This is really interesting to so many of us. And I was struck by you writing that, look, if you look at New York, right, it's undergoing a metamorphosis from a city dedicated to productivity to one built around pleasure. What are the consequences of that? Because it's not just New York, right?
Well, thank you. Thank you, Paula. And on one hand, we got offices are still at kind of 50% occupancy of what it was before COVID. But at the same time, we really want to meet. We need to meet. I mean, we've done a lot of research at MIT showing that if we don't meet, our social networks suffer a lot. And so what's happening, we believe, and this is a piece of research we've been doing together with Ed Glaser, who's a colleague and a professor at Harvard, we believe what's happening is actually that we are finding a new way to meet, and that's not necessarily in the office, in the cubicle. We don't want to spend too much time there, but actually find new ways to meet in the city, and that's what we started calling the playground city.
And when we talk about the playground city, is there anything that comes to mind for you, not a whole city, but even places in cities that would be what it looks like, what it would look like?
Well, I think, you know, some of the images you showed and some of the images we're seeing, especially in these kind of beautiful spring days in New York, is really, again, is doing work, is meeting other people, is kind of strengthening our social network, but in different ways. It's about meeting, again, in cafes, about using the city as an urban parlor and finding, again, new ways to meet, not necessarily in the old cubicle.
Okay, and to make this happen, it's not just going to be good faith or the fact that we want to see friends. You're saying that there need to be practical things put in place. I'll name one of them, and that's the end of what you call single-use zoning. Well, what is that, and what do cities need to do?
Well, you know, that's one of the important things. You know, if you think about zoning determines what type of users you got in different parts of the city, especially single-use zoning, or you got one single use. And what we've seen, especially after COVID, is that users are getting more and more mixed. You know, we work from home. We, you know, we are blurring the boundaries between the old kind of zoning. And the first thing, if you actually remove some of those constraints, the city will adapt much faster to this kind of new condition. So the city, we believe, will still be very lively. It's certainly not dead. It's just changing skin.
Interesting. So in some of the skyscrapers that we're looking at now, and remember, people in cities and towns really all over the world post-pandemic can relate to this. So you see a building that's maybe completely empty, half empty. In terms of converting it, many people have said that, look, this is a tough ask because those commercial buildings that we're looking at are not made the way most of us want to live. And your solution actually kind of almost looks like communal living in a way. Explain.
Yeah, well, you know, first of all, you want to look at a lot of programming, but then the other thing is saying, and the other thing you have to remember is still, you know, we're still using a lot our office. It is 50%, in other cities it might be 70%, you know, outside of the United States, 80%. So somehow, you know, it's not that we need to convert everything, but if we need to convert the towers, well, it depends on the typology. You're right, some of the typologies from, say, the 60s and 70s with very big floor plans are a bit more difficult. We might have some different type of programming, but there's also very successful examples of office towers having been converted. Think about the Chicago Tribune Tower in Chicago.
And I don't have a lot of time left, but a lot of people say that, look, some of these cities need to be places where people desperate for housing can actually go. Have you engaged with cities and towns that have this front of mind? It can't just be for rich people.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's a very important question. That's related to affordability, how affordable a city is. But somehow what is happening, this kind of transformation and maybe some of the conversion of the existing commercial real estate, well, could really make our cities more affordable. But the important thing, and again, we have been looking at that with a lot of research, analyzing the MIT campus, you know, a lot of the big data showing social network on the MIT campus, is we need to meet in physical space. Maybe not in the old office tower, but physical space is very important. It's actually the way we sustain and enrich our social networks.
Yeah, and I'm so glad that you say that, because when you say social networks, you do not mean the ones, you know, online. You mean the real ones that we can touch, feel, and see. A fascinating conversation, and we'll continue to see how our cities adapt. Appreciate it. Now.